So it's my pleasure to bring forward the mayor of our city, Carl Gerlach.
Thank you, Brad. Thank you very much. Good afternoon. I want to start by telling you a story. It was standing room only. A woman waited. So many thoughts running through her mind, she could barely remember all of her own thoughts. A developer was presenting a new and unique mixed-use program, a project in Overland Park that included residential, office, retail, and entertainment space. The proposal? Well, it would boost the local economy. Residents were interested. They were interested in density, traffic patterns, land uses, the impact on their own property values. The woman spoke from the podium, addressing the council, and she addressed the developer with her ideas. Each word that was spoken by either the citizen or the developer, regardless of the perspective, was heard and respected by all the members of the Overland Park City Council. You see, development in Overland Park brings with it exciting opportunities. But for residents, it can also bring support or concern. The City Council wants and encourages expression on all points of view when contemplating these very important projects and decisions they make. Their decision has to be sensitive, has to be respectful of to the current issues, but ultimately, they have to consider what's best for the entire community. It's that careful deliberation, interaction, and balancing the need for development that has allowed Overland Park to succeed. You know, this scenario plays itself out many times a year at the City Council meetings and at the Public Planning Commission meetings. Well, welcome, and Brad, thank you very much for that very nice introduction. I'd like to express first by giving my appreciation to Tracy and the Chamber Board of Directors for the opportunity to share with you the outstanding qualities of Overland Park. To Tracy and her entire staff, thank you for your continuous commitment. That means a lot to the City of Overland Park and for arranging all of today's events. To the 6 companies who are corporate partners, also to the 9 corporate sponsors, and also to those 4 new leadership circles, I want to thank you personally for expressing your appreciation of support to the Chamber, but also to the City of Overland Park, and for your participating in making this one of the best communities in the entire nation. Also to Brett Mitchell, Lori Kennedy, the Food and Beverage Director, thank you for your dedicated staffs for being here. Did you enjoy the lunch? Was it pretty good? I think it was very good. Also want to introduce the council. The council is very important. Their collaboration, their support, their hard work, their dedication to the City of Overland Park really makes this community continue to grow and prosper. If I can introduce them, if they could stand, and we'll hold our applause until the end. First, in Ward 1, Council Members Dave Jansen and Terry Happershire. Ward 2, our Council President Paul Lyons and Kurt Skoog. Ward 3, Jim Kite and Dave White. Ward 4, Terry Goodman and Fred Spears. Ward 5, John Scoobel and John Thompson. And Ward 6, Dan Stock and Rick Collins. Thank you very much for all the work that you guys do. If you've been coming, you know I also like to update you on my family. Sorry, it's my personal prerogative. My wife is here, Jill. She's great support to me, and I want to thank you very much. She and my son, Chris, I think, have been here for about the last 5 or 6. She's been here 10. He may have missed 1 or 2, but they've been here in big support. Chris and Jill, thank you very much. Now, there's another family member that's here. You've heard me talk of her. You know, one of the reasons I do this is to make this community so nice that I could get my daughter to move back from Dallas. Guess what? Jill and Ryan, can you stand up? They got married and they moved back here this year. So I think we got things going in the right direction. My other daughter, Katie, isn't here, but I told her it was much more important. She's student teaching right now, and I said, the interviews and the student teaching is much more important for you to stay there. Don't come to this luncheon. There's one other person I'd like to introduce, and that is Paul Loggie, who's the CEO and president of Gill Studios. That's where I have my full-time job. And I just want to thank Paul, and Paul, if you could stand. Paul is the reason he supports community activity, he supports everything that goes on, and because of Paul, I appreciate all your support in being able to do this mayor thing also. And finally, I want to thank the staff, the city staff members. Many of them are back there, some of them are seated throughout the audience, for helping me prepare today's event. They're gonna help us get much better informed. And that includes our city manager, Bill Ebel, Sean Riley, and his entire staff. It's a great group of people, and that's why today hopefully goes without a hitch. As you know, information is important. Matter of fact, I'm sure you're most aware of it, but a very important day for Kansas City is coming around just a short 25 days from today. It's the 2016 home opener of the World Series champions, Kansas City Royals, April 3rd against the New York Mets. They're also going to be raising that World Series flag, and so the entire nation is going to be watching Kansas City. How sweet is that? As I said last year, in my state of the city, 2015 was the year of Overland Park experience. Well, 2016 continues to be the year of the experience, but it's also the year of collaboration. Effective partnerships and agreements come about due to collaboration. Successful communities like Overland Park thrive on collaboration. Our formula for success has been in place nearly 56 years. It's collaboration. It's collaboration that generates jobs and strengthens and propels our economy. It's collaboration that brings private and public investments together. It's collaboration that supports nationally recognized educational programs. It's collaboration that provides for strong and safe neighborhoods. It validates our direction, and our vision. It allows us to reinvent areas of our community through new and redeveloped land use. For instance, think about it. You may recall just a mile down the street here, there was a popular restaurant called Dick Clark's American Bandstand a few years ago. Today, it's iFly. This year, from 71st Street to 91st Street, all along Metcalf, you're going to witness efforts to reinvent neighborhoods and retail centers all along Overland Park. This is what communities must do to stay viable and attractive. Construction begins this summer on redevelopment at the northeast corner of 71st and Metcalf. That project is called 71 Metcalf. It's a maintenance-provided luxury townhomes. It'll have a putting green. It'll have personalized gardens, outdoor kitchen, entertainment facilities. Jill, we may look at this. I'm a good place to move. Downtown Overland Park is a beacon of economic strength with an appealing quality of life. Strong business community, emerging culture, and a growing creative class. That is exactly what we wanted to happen when the city created the Downtown Overland Park Partnership and then later built the Matt Ross Community Center. But over the span of the next 24 months, Downtown Overland Park's skyline will change, resulting in more jobs, entertainment, residents, and shopping. There's four mixed-use projects that are bringing private and public investment together and added energy to this vibrant historic district. Those four. First, the View It's a $39 million redevelopment project with over 200 luxury living units, retail space, off-street parking, and the southeast corner of 80th and Marty Street. The next one, on the northwest corner of the same intersection, next to the farmer's market, is Market Lofts. It's a $9 million redevelopment project with over 35 living units. Then there's Interurban Lofts, a $10 million redevelopment project that is being built on the southwest corner of 79th and Concert. It will feature high-end multi-residential units, office space, and underground parking. And then Avenue 80, as I mentioned last year, it's a $50 million redevelopment project. Construction has already begun on this over 200 high-end living units, retail and office space, all fronting right on Metcalf. You see, people want to live and work in downtown Overland Park. They also want entertainment, cultural options, and a vibrant social dynamic. Nicole Emanuel, a local artist with a big vision and a lot of community spirit, has been a consistent advocate for creating a cultural center in downtown Overland Park. It is her hope, and ours also, that downtown Overland Park Post Office will be the new location for Nicole's interurban art house. Quote, she says, the post office would be an oasis of affordable arts, culture, and space for the community. At her current temporary location, the art house already is serving over 4,000 people annually. Artists collaborate with each other. They instruct students from 6 elementary schools and 2 high schools in the Shawnee Mission School District, and they encourage greater interest in performing, visual, and fine arts. That oasis of art, culture, and lifestyle is extending to the new Johnson County Arts and Heritage Center at 87th and Metcalf. It's located in the iconic, if you grew up here as I did, the iconic King Louis Building. Construction has begun on the center, and it will house the Johnson County Museum, the Johnson County Parks and Rec, along with their art classes, and they'll also house the Theater in the Park, will be there. And then in addition, the Overland Park Historic Society will be moving its operations to the center next year. Excuse me. You see, embracing culture, arts is one of the true pillars of building and maintaining a successful community that brings residents, visitors, and businesses. Last year I mentioned Promontory. Promontory is a $97 million shopping center on the northeast corner of 91st and Metcalf. Demolition is expected to begin later this summer. On the building just to the east of that popular Jay Gilbert's restaurant that I'm sure most of you know, it includes living units over top of retail. What is taking place in downtown Overland Park along Metcalf at 95th and Nall and 95th and Antioch is due largely to the significant community outreach that was used to develop the Vision Metcalf plan and reinvent land use. All of this reinvention of land use also got us thinking this year. What about reinventing some city services? Oh, God.
This is reinvented trash collection.
Seriously?
The sanitation worker comes to you.
Darn, the Jayhawks are putting it together again.
And celebrates your disposal.
In there, Mary, you still got it.
This is the reinvented traffic cup.
Do you have any idea how fast you're going back there?
No, sir.
Mr. Mayor, I believe that's your personal best.
He encourages your need for speed.
Say hi to your wife and kids.
See you tomorrow.
This is the reinvented road construction zone.
Good afternoon, Mr. Mayor. Iced skinny mocha latte, just the way you like it.
Thank you. You know, I don't mind these orange barrels anymore. Matter of fact, I kind of like construction zones.
The road worker is not only a barista, he's also a stand-up comedian.
So, a council member, chamber member, and codes administrator walked into a bar.
We're also looking at some other city services that reinvent. I'm kind of personally wanting to look at something on the golf course that throws my ball back in the fairway after I hit it out of bounds. But just wait, these city services can't wait till they come to your area of the city, can't you? You know, thousands of residents, business owners, community leaders, planners and others came together to reinvent the future of Metcalf Avenue. Over $100 million of private money is going into five multi-story mixed-use projects envisioned in the Vision Metcalf plan. Millions more are going into smaller projects along the Metcalf corridor study area. The construction value of building permits within the study area in the last 2 years alone is about $90 million, triple the value of the three previous years. Now development is going on further south also, near the 159th Street and US 69 corridor. This interchange is due to a first of its kind three-way partnership between the state, the city, and a private developer. The Kansas Department of Transportation, Price Brothers, and the Overland Park all contributed to the cost of this $18.9 million project. Price Brothers owns and develops the land on the southwest corner of this new interchange. All of us together collaborated on a process involving public and private contributions to make this physically possible but responsible. One of the things that we've seen from the recession is a new pattern of development and redevelopment. Developers are often seeking public investment, and no matter how you feel and your thoughts are on the city's making this investment, it has become clear that development and redevelopment would not occur without this partnership. But there is a need to address how and when the city should offer investment tools to developers. So we reached out and we sought feedback from members of the Overland Park Chamber, from Blue Valley and Shawnee Mission School Districts, from Johnson County Government on a tax increment financing policy for our city. I believe we're one of the first major metropolitan communities to enact a TIF policy like this one. It balances the needs for redevelopment in established areas of Overland Park that struggle while providing responsible public investment to grow businesses and commercial areas. An investment like this protects property values and strengthens the surrounding neighborhoods also. We're seeing this resulted in redevelopment and reinvestment that is going on. In an analysis recently told us just last week, assessed valuations in the northern part of the city increased 6%, and in the southern part of the region, 3-4%. See, the policy protects school districts. It protects Johnson County Library. It protects Johnson County Community College, the state and the city and others, and it ensures each receives 100% of the current property tax revenue that's already coming to that property. Each benefits then from higher property valuations because of the redevelopment. For instance, the Shawnee Mission School District property valuations in Overland Park increased $84 million since 2012, and $319 million for Blue Valley School District, providing more tax revenue for each one of the school districts. This demonstrates how city's commitment and investment in development and redevelopment and quality infrastructure really benefits all of us together. Our TIF policy then, in addition to that, allocates an additional 10% more, if not more, of the new tax increment back to those government entities. It promotes redevelopment and jobs. It's actually an economic stimulus for our community. Evaluation of these proposed TIF projects follows an established procedure that's outlined by the state of Kansas. The city now includes additional guidance on how and when these should be considered. Your city council identified priority geographic regions which make a TIF request more favorable for consideration. Those areas include downtown Overland Park and along Metcalf Avenue, along the Vision Metcalf plan, and also Shawnee Mission Parkway up north. Developers do need to communicate with those public agencies that are affected by TIF prior to any consideration by the City Council. We will assess the economic and financial feasibility of every one of these projects, and I can assure you that when Deputy City Manager Christy Stallings begins that process, you can consider it fully assessed. Expiration of a TIF will normally occur in about 20 years, unless that project is so successful as many of the few that we've done have been, and they'll pay off even sooner than that 20 years. You know, the next project the City Council's been working on is a new approved rental licensing and a proactive inspection program that we believe will maintain the livability of our neighborhoods. There are over 28,000 residential rental properties in Overland Park. That includes single family, duplex, triplexes, apartment complexes. Well, a collaborative effort on this new program involved a task force comprised of representatives from landlord and rental associations, retail property owners, neighborhood leaders, council members, and staff members. You see, safe, well cared for, and stable neighborhoods are the soul and the essence of Overland Park. You want that. I want that. The City Council wants it. And the community, well, they demand it and expect it. But in the last survey that we did, only 60% of our residents were satisfied with the enforcement of property codes, while maintenance of residential properties was the second highest priority for our residents. But right now, there's a proposal in the Kansas legislature to take away any ability for cities to implement and to manage a rental licensing and inspection program. It would prevent our city from fulfilling what our residents and our businesses want: protection from rental properties that are not appropriately maintained. We would be glad to collaborate with state lawmakers as they consider this bill, which may have far-reaching and unintended consequences. Another project. 2 years ago, we were fortunate that a high school student reached out to the Overland Park City Council and discussed a new program for us. The council listened to our new high school citizens, and at her urging, initiated a teen council. It's a collaborative opportunity for Overland Park High School students to learn more about local government, to be involved in service projects, and to gain community leadership and experience. I'd like to take an opportunity to introduce three of those students that were able to get away from classes today. They are Ahmad Akam. I think he's right there. He is. He can stand up, please. Akisha Varma and Lydia Meese. Thank you very much. This community's commitment to education of our kids is rooted in early existence more than 100 years ago. That began with our founder, William Strang Jr., who was a businessman and an entrepreneur but understood education. It is one of our primary and founding tenets of building a great community. I want to take this moment to congratulate, but again recognize Dr. Todd White from Blue Valley's new superintendent. Although he's been here in this community for about a year now, the school district, he began his job less than 2 weeks ago. And I understand will be taking over at the end of this semester. Dr. White was promoted from within following a national search and an involved community outreach effort to find out what patrons were seeking for in their new leader. Dr. White, thank you very much for being here. Real collaboration brings value, ideas, and opportunities. Collaboration brought this convention center and the hotel next door, and it's benefiting corporate Overland Park and the entire community. Both the convention center and the hotel came about due to a 15-year partnership between the city, the Chamber of Commerce, and the Overland Park CVB, Convention and Visitors Bureau. Right now, our community is poised to become a major destination for leisure and business travel. According to 2015 data compiled by the Overland Park Convention and Visitors Bureau, spending by visitors in Overland Park was $732 million, supporting over 10,000 jobs. A portion of that $732 million comes from visitors who are shopping in Overland Park, contributing to our sales tax that helps fund our city government, especially our neighborhood streets and our thoroughfares. When you think about it, the Deanna Rose Farmstead, Shields Overland Park Soccer Complex, Prairie Fire Museum, Downtown Overland Park Farmers Market, the Overland Park Arboretum and Botanical Garden, and the Nerman Museum, all are activities that draw leisure visitors and corporations to our city. I want to thank Dana Markle, president of the Overland Park CVB back here, and her entire staff. Dana's team is embarking on a strategic plan to determine our best path forward. At your table today, there's an annual visitor's guide. Take it with you. It's more of a magazine this year, but it's a terrific resource when you're looking for fun things to do in Overland Park. Having and supporting successful businesses in this city is vital. In 2015, Overland Park gained over 1,000 new jobs. We retained over 2,000, easily surpassing 2014. New jobs last year, the average wage of those 1,000 new jobs exceeded $70,000. And the capital investment from those companies was over $101 million. Companies that consider Overland Park talk about our economic development team led by Tracy Osborne and Beth Johnson. The duo highlight the benefits of doing business in Overland Park and the city's commitment to physical leadership, affordability, outstanding quality of life for company employees. Reasons to consider Overland Park include the city's low and therefore competitive property tax rate. Tell you what, next time you get your property tax bill out, look at your property tax bill and note that Overland Park's portion is only 12% or less of your total bill. An owner of a $250,000 house pays only $369 in property taxes to the city for an entire year of services. And with some of those new services coming on, it's not too bad, right? Let's break that down a little bit. Generally, this property tax equates to $65 or less than 18 cents a day for police services, $44 a year for fire services, $34 for parks, $106 for streets, $15 for planning and development, and $45 for capital maintenance and city facilities. Today, our mill rate for property taxes is only 2 mills higher than it was 21 years ago. Overland Park still has the lowest mill levy rate of any city in Johnson County and of all first-class cities in the entire state of Kansas. Because of these efforts in 2015, Overland Park has received national recognition from several independent sources. Among some of these honors, Overland Park is rated the number one among the top 10 best cities for families. Overland Park has received an A+ in the 10 best Midwest cities to live in. Overland Park was number 15 among America's best cities to live, and Overland Park was number 14 on the list of top 100 best places to live. Collaborative efforts by local community leaders, including school and county officials and many others that began more than 56 years ago, set a positive direction and destiny for Overland Park. Actually, in 1960, voters of the Mission Urban Township, an unincorporated area in Johnson County, agreed to incorporate as Overland Park a first-class city. That vote was an act of local control, the first critical step in our city's development and success. Residents wanted a city to call their own, a representative government to make decisions, to set standards, to levy taxes, and to make expenditures that would meet the community's needs. In other words, local representatives who would directly be responsible for their vision to get Overland Park figuratively and literally on the map. What they wanted was quality city services, elected leaders that were responsive to the voices of the people, to ensure prosperity and to make sound decisions, to support businesses and quality education, and to create and sustain a vibrant neighborhoods. They wanted to make their vision a reality. Actually, back then, the city was 13 square miles with slightly more than 28,000 residents, located primarily in the downtown Overland Park area that is today. But today, I think we've done what the citizens would like, because we're over 187,000 people, making us the 128th largest city in the entire nation. It covers more than 75 square miles and includes almost 2,000 lane miles of streets. And from 2010 to 2014, Overland Park had a 6% population growth rate, the highest among Johnson County cities of populations greater than 75,000 people. This demonstrates that we have been responsive to our citizens and to our community's needs, doesn't it? All facets of our local economy and education systems require public investment. From streets to sidewalks, snow plows, police, fire, government buildings, traffic signals, street lights, parks, pools, trails. Professional government has a participative role, a role which requires collaborative investment to create, to build, and to sustain. Our quality of life is a direct result of the foresight of past and current leaders to provide essential public services, to plan and build infrastructure and create community amenities that residents, that businesses and visitors want and need. That is what local representative government closest to the people does best. It is also why we are witnessing a surging interest in development and redevelopment along the Metcalf corridor, including recreational opportunities like Topgolf and iFly, along with other new products. It doesn't just happen on its own. Somebody had to make it happen. In contrast, today the quality of life for residents and businesses in Overland Park and all local communities in Kansas is threatened. It has to do with local control. Some state lawmakers in Topeka want to take local control away from local elected officials. An example is the 2015 state-mandated property tax lid. This legislation is nothing more than a pair of handcuffs on local representative government, which the state did not even apply to themselves. The effort is to diminish the essence of representative democracy at the local level. This week, state lawmakers are considering two different tax bill lid amendments. The first one is the Senate bill. The current tax bill is more onerous and more restrictive than even last year's on local government. The Kansas House, though, proposes a little bit more reasonable additions to the current lid that was put in place last year. Kansas lawmakers should not repeat the actions of last year when they passed a property tax lid with no public discussion and in the middle of the night. That any consideration regarding property tax lid should be transparent and truly collaborative, working and communicating with cities, with counties, with business leaders from all across Kansas, all of whom are investors in our prosperity and our quality of life. Overland Park has had a long had a policy of maintaining low property taxes. We rolled property taxes back from 1999 to 2003 in response to the growth of appraised values. Our property tax rate increased then in 2012 only after weathering 4 years of revenue losses that depleted Overland Park's reserves. In that 4-year span, we reduced capital improvements by 60%. We eliminated 60 positions, that's truly including actual layoffs, and eliminated or reduced compensation increases across the board for all employees. We restructured our employee retirement programs during that 4 years, and we reduced critical maintenance expenditures. Just to give you an example, the average Overland Park house in 1999 was $149,000. And they paid $147 for city property taxes. The average home in 2015 is $257,000. Property taxes paid to the city of Overland Park when adjusted for inflation are only $267 a year. That's an increase of only $7 a year. We've been fiscally responsible in light of population growth, recession, increasing demand on city services. You know, our majority of our residents have repeatedly said in community surveys that they are satisfied or very satisfied with the value of taxes they pay to Overland Park. So it is really difficult to understand why the state feels compelled to limit our ability to govern at the local level. We have a proven track record of success, but state lawmakers from the city, they hear from us at the city all the time. Some state lawmakers need to hear from you. I want to say that again. The state lawmakers in Topeka need to hear from you. It's important for what you say, because you can determine what happens in Topeka. Some of those Kansas legislators, even from our area, say that they want to hear from real people. They don't consider me real people representing you. So on your table is a list of the Kansas senators and the Kansas representatives representing Johnson County. I know many of you already talked to them, but your voice matters. Pick up your phone right now, or when you get back to the office, let them hear from you. Send all of them an email that says local control is important. You can make a difference. You can influence your state and your community's future. Local control allows your city government to work closely with businesses, the Overland Park Chamber, with our residents, and others to determine what is the most appropriate for this city. Overland Park and cities across the state of Kansas have done well managing our own circumstances for decades. We are proud to be part of this outstanding state in the greatest nation on earth. In the many conversations that I have had with state and local officials, I sense a strong desire to create a new path forward, a path which will lead to greater quality of life and opportunity for every business and every citizen to prosper. So let's engage in a collaborative process where we can succeed as partners starting today. As Kansans, it is essential we do so for our future. If we do so, then the entire state will benefit from our collaborative leadership. I want to thank you for the opportunity to be your mayor in this great city. It's an honor to serve you. Thank you very much.
This is dangerous. This is the danger zone. You want me to go like this, like in front of him? It's unsafe, but I can do this.
It's so wrong.
A little bit.
It's so wrong.
A little bit.
It's so right. Do it to me.
Okay. Do you have any idea?
Well, that's too fast.
You want me to get into him? Who came up with this idea?
Let's celebrate.
Celebrate. Celebrate.
Thank you. You know, I don't mind these construction zones anymore.
That's pretty good, except it sounded like a gunshot. Hang
on. Did you hear the one about the council member, chamber member, and codes administrator? We're gonna have to do that again.
Darn, the Jayhawks are putting it together again.
In there, Mayor, you still got it.
You got the ball in the tight up here.
Okay.
Darn, the Jayhawks gonna put it together again.
In there, Mayor, you still got it.